Perfect. Okay, so hello everybody. Thanks a lot for the invitation. And I'm really happy to present this work. So it has been the work, I would thank the organizer to invite me. I think it's a really good opportunity, and I would say a weird symposium for us because it's a late or early date in France. So I'll be happy to participate. Okay, anyway, so today I will talk about work that has been done in the lab by two really talented, oops, doesn't work. No. Yep, of two talented PhD students, so Laure Asselin and José Rivera. So this work is dealing with the role of the kinase in KIF21B, and that we saw that is a quite atypical kinase during cortical development. So I will give a really short introduction on cortical development because I guess it's something that we are really familiar with. So as you know, the cortex is the superficial layer of the brain, and also there is striking differences between human and mouse cortices. The overall organization is really conserved between the mouse and the human, with this organization in six layers of the cortex that is composed of, each of those layers are composed of two main type of neurons, the glutamatergic production neurons and the GABAergic interneurons. So today I will focus on the development of the glutamatergic projection neurons in this part of the cortex. So just to summarize what is happening, the neurons are derived from an homogeneous pool of progenitors. Those progenitors will amplify and then divide asymmetrically to give rise to neurons, either directly or indirectly, and then migrate through the cortical plate along via glia fibers. I will come back to that, and differentiate to form proper local and distant connection. And what is important to remind here is that the three different states, so the proliferation, neurogenesis, the migration and differentiation should be tightly regulated to allow the proper formation of the cortex. And according to that, actually any defect in those different processes is associated with neurodevelopmental disorders. And among those neurodevelopmental disorders, we can find the malformation of the cortex. Those malformations encompass different... Yes. Right. Can you hear me? Oh. Yeah.
Yes, I can hear.
Okay, sorry. So those... Among those different malformations, we have lysencephaly, microcephaly, that is a small brain, lysencephaly, that is a small brain, and different ectopic neurons like heterotopia, subcortical band heterotopia, or periventricular nodular heterotopia. Thanks to the whole exome sequencing, a lot of genes have been associated with those different disorders. And here I listed some of them. It's not exhaustive, but it's just, I just want here to emphasize that among those genes, a lot have been associated with microtubule and microtubule cytoskeleton. So you have here in blue the genes encoding for tubulin subunits, and in red, the genes encoding for molecular motors. And among those, you can find a lot of kinesins. So overall, this shows that the tubulin and the integrity of the microtubule cytoskeleton and the associated protein is really important for the development of the cortex. And among the kinesin, we found the KIF21B as a really interesting kinesin. So KIF21B is a molecular motor working on microtubule. It's responsible of the anterograde transport of various cargos among microtubules, and it's also involved in the regulation of microtubule dynamics. So this protein has a several domain, and an N-terminal motor domain, a central Col-Col domain, and the C-terminal WDR40 domain that is thought to be involved in the binding to the cargos. So there is, among those domains, there is three domains that have been shown to be interacting with the microtubules, including the motor domain that is involved in the motility cargo transport. The two other domains, microtubule binding domain, I've been rather involved in the microtubule dynamics function of K21B. So in collaboration with clinicians, a large group of clinicians, we have found different variants along the K21B genes in patients presenting with different neurodevelopmental symptoms. And among those symptoms, all of them are developing intellectual disabilities. And you can see that some of them show also malformation like microcephaly or corpus callosum agenesis, but others do not show any brain abnormalities. So I won't talk about this last mutation variants today. So as we have shown that 21B is a neuronal protein, so it's expressed exclusively in neurons, we focus our attention on migration. And we analyze whether those variants could impair or not the migration. So we use the classical in utero electroporation methods to express the variants in the wild type embryo at E14.5. And we analyzed the position of the electroporated cells that are green or expressing GFP at E18. And what we do show is that while the wild-type protein does not show any, the overexpression of the wild-type protein does not impair migration, so you do see that the cells are reaching the upper layer of the cortex, as does the empty vector. The expression of the different variants, as you can see here, so the cells expressing those variants fail to correctly migrate with a lot of cells at the intermediate zone at E18. So showing that KIF21B variants impair migration. And for those two variants, so the Q313K and the A1001T, the migration, the migration is delayed while when you look at postnatal stages, while the for this variant, the migration is completely impaired, as we see a lot of cells that are still stuck in the IZ at later stage in postnatal stages. So we next try to understand the mode of action of those variants. And for that, we thought it was, so as it's dominant mutations, like de novo mutation, we thought that there might be a dominant mutation and especially, now I lost my words, dominant negative mutation. And so to test that, we co-express the variants together with increasing level of amount of the wild-type protein to see whether we will be able to rescue or not the phenotype. And actually for the three cases, it's not the case. So we fail to rescue the phenotype by increasing the level of the wild-type protein, meaning that the mode of action is different from the dominant negative. So while doing this experiment, we actually realized that by increasing the level of the wild-type protein on the wild-type background, increasing the level of KIF21B in cells impair the migration of those cells, suggesting that more kinesin or more activity of the kinesin we have, the migration is impaired. So it was really interesting because actually there is this RCC domain for regulatory cocoa domain that is also called an autoinhibitory domain on other kinesin. And this domain is thought to be involved in the autoinhibition of the kinesin. So we reasoned that the different variants could release this autoinhibition and then enhance the activity of KIF21B. So we first tested that by trying to overexpress a protein that has lost the RCC domain, so basically a KIF21B protein that has that cannot be inactivated, and we show that we phenocopy the phenotype of the variants, meaning that we have cells that are that fail to migrate. So we next move to the variants, back to the variants, and we show that variants that are immotile, so the variants that are not able to hydrolyze the ATP, so not able to move along microtubule, do not those immotile variants the expression of those hemotype variants do not impair the migration. So really meaning that it's the hyperactivation and the hypermobility of those variants that is impairing the migration of the neurons. So basically, we showed that KISH21B impair migration by enhancing KISH21B motility activity through lessening of the kinesin auto-inhibition. So we think that there is a kind of a balance between the auto-inhibited state and the active state in the control condition. And when we overexpress the KISH21B variants, this is impaired, the balance is impaired in favor of the active state, and this hyperactivation leads to hypermobility that is deleterious for the migration of neurons. So as I told you at the beginning, there is different symptoms or like manifestation in the patient, and we focused, so today I will focus on corpus callosum agenesis, and actually we check whether the variants could actually be responsible of those defect malformation. So for that, we perform initial electroporation at T15 when the callosal neurons are born, and we analyze later on, so at P8 or P21, the branching, the axonal branching at P8 in the ipsilateral hemisphere, the passing through the midline, and the branching in the contralateral hemisphere. So here are the results. So you do see that expressing the wild type protein does not impair the formation of those axonal tracts, so the corpus callosum, neither this other mutation that is actually leading to microcephaly, but not corpus callosum. But now if we overexpress this mutation that is associated with corpus callosum defect in human patients, you do see that it strongly impaired the formation of the corpus callosum. And again, to try to find the mode of action, we try to rescue with increasing amount of wild-type protein, and it fails to rescue, meaning that it's not a dominant negative effect. And we express the delta RCC that is not able to, that is for which the hyperactivated form of KISH21B. And we see that we phenocopy the phenotype. And now if we overexpress the protein that is not motile, the phenotype, we don't see the phenotype. So here again, it seems that the overexpression, that the hyperactivity of this mutant is impairing the formation of this corpus callosum. We next look at the ipsilateral hemisphere here and look at the branching of the axon. So you do see that the callosal neurons are branching of axons collaterals in the layer 5 in the control condition when we overexpress K21B and when we overexpress this control mutant. But when we overexpress this mutant, so the E617L, you do see that there is a strong decrease of axon collaterals, suggesting that, again, these mutants alter the intra-hemispheric connectivity as the inter-hemispheric connectivity. So we again try to find the mode of action, and here it was really surprising, but we do see that the overexpression or like the increasing amount of KISH21B was able to rescue the phenotype, as you can see here, so increasing amount of KISH21B. So suggesting that in that case, it's a dominant negative mechanism. So which function of KISH21B is important there? So we repeat this experiment by overexpressing wild-type protein, but this time a wild-type protein that cannot bind the ATP, in that case, or that cannot hydrolyze the ATP with this point mutant. And we do see that in that case, we fail to rescue the phenotype, suggesting that it's really the motility of KISH21B that is important for that phenotype too. So suggesting that the variants play a dominant negative on the motility function of the endogenous protein. We confirm that, showing that actually the delta RCC, so the hyperactive KISH21B, does not induce a phenotype. So in that part, I showed that the expression of the variant in mice, so I don't show the zebrafish here, recapitulate neurodevelopmental phenotype, so showing that the KIF21B is a candidate for disease pathogenesis. I show you that missense mutation at different extent in perineuronal migration by enhancing KIF21B motor activity, and I showed different that this mutant perturbs both the axonal growth through an autoinhibition release mechanism and the axonal branching through a dominant negative mechanism. So basically, our working model is that minimum level of autoinhibition is required to ensure proper function of T21B. And we think that in the white hat condition, we have a disbalance between an autoinhibition and active form of KIF21B. And in case of KIF21B mutation, we have release of autoinhibition. So with the severity of the phenotype correlating with the amount of release, I would say. So the more release, the release is the autoinhibition, or the more active is the kinesin, the more severe will be the phenotype. And in that model, the E670LL will be here, and the two other mutants in that part. So with that, I would like to show some unpublished data and to show the physiological role of KIF21B. So we show that KIF21B regulates radial migration by using shRNA. So we are electroporating shRNA, and we show that two different shRNA leads to impaired migration in vivo in the cortex. And to further explore that, we perform time-lapse recording and we analyze radial migration. So radial migration starts with the cells going out of the IZ, and then they transform into a multipolar stage, then they transform back to a bipolar stage and start locomotion along the glia fibers. And along this journey, they will stop, become a bit multipolar and go back to a bipolar stage to complete their migration. So we analyzed those kind of movies, and actually we showed that the first step are not involved. So the transition to bipolar, the multipolar to bipolar is not impaired upon KIF21B mutation. But we showed that locomotion is impaired. So we showed that actually, as you can see here, the travel of those neurons depleted for KIF21B is shorter. So we analyze those different parameters. We show that there is a decrease of the mean velocity of those neurons. So we show that they are posing more for longer duration, and that they are transiting, once they start locomotion, they are transiting more through by a multipolar stage. Overall, we show also that if you remove the posing from the mean velocity, we show that the velocity when they actually move is also decreased. Okay, so basically we show that this glia-guided locomotion is affected. So this locomotion is, there is a nucleokinesis during this locomotion that allows the forward movement of the nucleus. And we analyze that. We show that the nucleokinesis was impaired too, and the duration was increased. And we showed that during the migration, there is a lot of over branching of the neurons. As you can see here, the number of branches is increased, but those branches that you can see here are shorter, but overall the total length of the branches is increased. So basically we show that a lot of parameters are impaired during migration upon KIF21B depletion. So we next try to understand the mechanism. And for that, again, we try to rescue with different truncated protein. So the wild type is rescuing. And when we delete the motor domain, we do rescue. When we use a KIF21B that cannot move, then here, surprisingly, we rescue the phenotype. And when we deplete the C-terminal part that is supposed to be linked to the cargo, we also rescue, meaning that KIF21B motility, effect on migration is independent of its role on motility along microtubule. So if it's not motility, what could it be? So we first thought it could be microtubule dynamics, but we perform mass spectrometry on KIF21B IPs on core disease, and we show we actually found a lot of actin binding proteins, among them actin, the top hit, whether on actin or myosin or dalbin. So we thought it would be really interesting to check whether kifanimib could actually regulate actin dynamics, and it was quite surprising for a kinase. So then we show that KIF21B is actually binding to the kinesin in the cortex, or so binding to the F-actin in the cortex. We also show by IP that KIF21B interacts with actins, whether with through KIF21B IP or actin IPs. And we also show that KIF21B is actually interacting with myosin. So altogether, this KIF21B might be an actin binding protein, and for that we check whether KIF21B could alter the actin dynamics in vivo. So we perform time-lapse recording using LifeFact Ruby to follow the actin contraction. And in the control condition, we show that KIF21B, there is a burst of KIF21B contraction at the rear or at the front of the nucleus. At the front of the nucleus during the nucleokinesis, and this drop, as you can see here, after nucleokinesis. In the KIF21B depletion condition, you can see that you still have this burst of actin contraction at the front of the nucleus, but this is keeping high even after nucleokinesis. So we think that, so this is a work ongoing, but we think that there is a defect of actin dynamics upon KIF21B depletion. So with that, I would end, I think, so this is the overall model. So we think that the proper dosage of KIF21B activities is essential for proper neuronal migration. So I showed you that activity of KIF21B through the expression of KIF21B variants is impairing migration, and we think this is through hypermotility. On the contrary, I show you that the physiological role of T21B in the migration is independent of its motility or the processing or the motility positivity, and we think that it's rather that its function on actin is rather important for this physiological function. So with that, I will thank you again, Julian and Natalie, for the invitation, and all the people that participate to this project, our collaborators and the funding agency.
Thank you very much, Julian, for your very nice